I'm Don Stigall. Welcome to RCPylon.tv. This is a new YouTube channel I'm creating. It's going to be dedicated entirely to RC Pylon Racing. All forms of RC Pylon Racing will be covered on this channel. Everything from Q40s, like this Shark here, to little electric foamies, maybe even smaller planes than that. Maybe even smaller quadcopters. I'm the president of RC Pro, and RC Pro is an organization that was created to support all RC pylon racing. We founded RC Pro back in 2003 with Dan Kane, Tony Pacini, Paul Herman, and Ed Smith. Our goal was all RC pylon racing. However, that proved to be quite an undertaking, and in 2005 or 2006, we refocused RC Pro primarily on two-pole pylon racing. But we still support three-pole pylon racing, and we support the NMPRA and the USRA and any other group that's racing model airplanes or quadcopters. RC pylon racing is a diverse activity. There are many different classes and many different sets of rules. There are national rules that the AMA has for specific racing classes, and groups like RC Pro develop their own rules, and a lot of local clubs develop their own rules. Regardless of the rules and the classes, you're going to see coverage of those classes and events on this channel. We'll focus primarily on the classes that are more popular, but we'll cover the classes that are emerging and the classes that have been in the past, like Formula One, because things like Formula One go through phases. There's a renewed interest in model airplanes that raced in the 70s and the 80s and the 90s that made a lot of noise. We've also seen a lot of changes where electrics have become popular, and electrics have different challenges than glow and gas airplanes do in terms of creating parity that makes the competition fun. The AMA Pylon Racing Board dictates the rules that are used for the AMA events. Some events like NMPRA EF1 are developed by the NMPRA and may get submitted to the AMA as rules proposals in the future. Many classes have started out as somebody's idea of what to do, and then evolved into more formalized rules that are published and many groups adhere to. This airplane is a Q40 airplane. This airplane is based on a airplane that was used in record attempts in Brazil. Q40 allows any kind of airplane that's been used in a race or speed attempt, and otherwise this airplane wouldn't qualify. In the Formula One class of the 70s through the 90s, it was based on models that raced in the Formula One class. Q40 has evolved into the premier racing class in the US, other than FAI F3D, which has flown in a different manner than most of the racing in the US. Most of the racing in the U.S. is heads-up racing, where you race against each other and then you get points for your position in the heat. In FAI F3D, you're basically racing against the clock, even if there are multiple airplanes on the course. We'll cover FAI F3D on this channel as well, but our main focus is going to be on the events that are run in the U.S. and some international events. The Q40 airplanes in the U.S. are powered by either Jet Engineering engines, or Nelson engines. These engines turn well over 25,000 RPMs, and with these two mufflers, they produce almost 4 horsepower. With a 400 square inch wing and an airplane that weighs approximately 4 pounds, these airplanes reach speeds of up to 200 miles an hour and even over 200 miles an hour. Racing is performed on a three-pole course that is a quarter mile in distance. There are two pylons that are 100 feet apart, and 608 feet from those pylons is the number one pylon. The racing is done from on the course. Judging of the course used to be done from on the course, but at a certain point, it was determined that for safety reasons, off-course judging needed to be used. So only the pilots and the essential course workers are on the course while the races are being run. And the pilots have helpers called callers. These callers help the pilot know when to turn and watch for traffic on landing and basically coach the pilot through the race. Q40 airplanes fly very well. They don't typically have bad tendencies, but when you have an airplane going through the air at 200 miles an hour, it creates wake turbulence. So you can get into another plane's turbulence, and if you fly a consistent course, you can even wind up in your own turbulence, because with a 10 lap heat lasting around 1 minute, the lap times are about 6 seconds. So the disturbance in the air can linger for that amount of time. Most people don't start with Q40s, and there are many entry level classes that people start in. Throughout the rest of this video, I'm going to be showing some airplanes that fly in those different classes. We'll start with the AMA's entry-level racing class. This is an AMA 424 Sport Quickie Pylon Racer. I actually designed this airplane. It uses a wing that came from the Great Plains Viper 500, and the airfoil was actually designed by Dr. Michael Seeley. This airplane was jig built so it was straight, because if you have an airplane that's not straight, it doesn't fly straight. And learning to build airplanes that'll hold up to racing is an art in and of itself. Some of the advanced classes like Q40, most airplanes are molded composites because it takes a lot to hold up to 200 miles an hour. Sport Quickie's much less demanding. The wings are typically foam cores sheeted with balsa, and the balsa is usually held to the foam cores using the epoxy. In Sport Quickie, no composite wings are allowed. This is a foam core wing, and no composite tails are allowed in Sport Quickie. This is so that somebody can buy some balsa and some foam and get started racing at a reasonable price. The engines that are used have a particular specification, and in the case of Sport Quickie, only two engines are currently legal: the Thunder Tiger Pro 40, which has been discontinued, and the Evolution 46NX. And a standard prop, the APC 9x6, is specified for this racing class. Because the wing has to have a certain number of square inches, 500 square inches, and it has to be at least 1 3/16 of an inch thick, and there's a minimum height and a minimum width for the fuselage, it keeps the airplanes relatively even in terms of performance, which makes it a pilot's event. You can have the slickest airplane in the world, and if you can't fly the course, and if you can't finish races, you won't win races. So you've got to be able to take off, you've got to be able to fly, you got to be able to fly 10 good laps, and you got to be able to land and keep your airplane in one piece to even have a chance at winning a race. It's much more challenging than left turns. One of the cool things about three-pole pylon racing is you're racing on the course, so you can see your airplane relative to other airplanes pretty easily. And it's very exciting having airplanes coming near you and be able to pass people and see the perspective from the three-pole course. There's a higher level class called AMA 426 Super Sport Quickie that uses a specific engine. Currently, that engine is made by Jet Engineering. Composite wings and tails are allowed in 426. And a lot of people like the composite wings and the composite tails, especially because of consistency. Even at the speeds of these airplanes, the airfall is very important. And having ridges on a wing don't work very well. So building an airplane can be a bit of a challenge, but it's also very rewarding. Putting an airplane in the sky that you've built yourself, designed yourself, or simply prepared and gotten the engine ready is very exciting. And the more you practice, the better you get. And you can even practice using a simulator like Real Flight. There are courses and airplanes available that will let you practice without tearing up airplanes. I actually have a number of courses for Real Flight 6.5 and above, and those are available on rcpro.org and will be available on various other locations. Back in 2004 and 2005, one of the RC Pro board members and I had a serious discussion about entry-level pylon racing. What we decided was that people needed to be able to race planes that they could easily fly at their clubs. At the time, the SIG 4-Star 40 was a very popular airplane. The only problem was the wing on it did not have a D-tube leading edge, and the plane had been raced a fair amount by various groups in the country, but we looked for an airplane that was more sturdy and lower cost. There was a plane by the World Models called the Sky Raider Mach 2. The Sky Raider Mach 2 had a simple constant chord wing, and it basically looked like an oversized quickie with a canopy. So we developed the Club 40 rules around a specific wing area and other airframe restrictions, and we picked the engine that was used for AMA 424 Sport Quickie, the Thunder Tiger Pro 40, as the preferred engine for the racing class. This was so that people could start with Club 40 and advance to AMA 424 Sport Quickie. A number of people have done just that. In fact, the current NMPRA president, Trey Whitty, started out racing in Club 40, and he raced in both what we call the bronze class and the silver class. I put on races at Charlotte Motor Speedway in 2008 and 2009, and it proved to be quite popular. I wrote an article for Model Aviation that appeared in the October 2009 issue called Pylon Racing for Everyone. In Pylon Racing for Everyone, I featured the Sky Raider Mach 2 and this plane, the LA Racer 40. The World Models developed this airplane from the Sky Raider. It has the same wing plan form except for the very ends of the ailerons. And it has the same stabilizer as the Sky Raider Mach 2, but it has a rounded turtle deck and a rounded nose and a cowl, and some people think they look better. It's also a little bit heavier. It looks a little bit more streamlined because It does have a cowl, whereas the Sky Raider has open cheeks on it. And it may have a slight speed advantage, but it's a little bit heavier. And the heavier airplane doesn't turn as fast as a lighter airplane does. So a lot of people favor the Sky Raider Mach 2. At some point, a clone kit of the Sky Raider was created, and it was called the Club 40 Raider. It's been available for quite a while, but hasn't been lately. And there's still a lot of people who like to build their own airplanes. That kit, the Club 40 Raider, is being brought back by StegallHobbies.com as the Club 40 Racer. It'll actually have a battery hatch so that it can accommodate electrics. One of the things I've been working on for RC Pro is Club 40 Electric, because electrics have become extremely popular. The World Models has on their standard color scheme, LA Racers, a battery hatch. And these airplanes do very well with electric power. A couple of years ago, the RC Pro Club 40 committee, headed by Ken Erickson, approved the SIG 4-star 54 EPEG so that we would have a little bit more variety. We also added additional classes, including a gold class, which allows engines up to 0.46 cubic inches. We designated the silver class as 0.40 cubic inch engines, but unfortunately the Thunder Tiger Pro 40 was discontinued. The NMPRA and the AMA worked on the Sport Quickie rules as a result, and they added the Evolution 46NX. The RC Pro board voted to allow the Evolution 46NX in silver class as long as it has an APC 9x6 propeller, the same propeller that's required for Sport Quickie. In gold class, the Evolution 46 does not have a limitation on the propeller. Club 40 airplanes are extremely flying field friendly. They have a symmetrical airfoil. They'll do most anything you want to do with them. They do have a slight barrel roll. And there are some differences between the LA Racer and the Sky Raider Mach 2 in that the LA Racer has dual aileron servos outboard, where the Sky Raider has full strip ailerons and it has an internal servo. You can find the rules for Club 40 Racing at club40racing.com. Soon there will be rules for Club 40 Electric. I've been working on power systems for Club 40 Electric and have determined what size of batteries will not overpower the airplanes. One thing of note is that in 2007 or 2008, a rules proposal was approved by the AMA Executive Council. It's called the AMA 540B document. It defines Club 40, and it also defines Quickie 25, and it defines a two-pole course where the pylons are 400 feet apart, and they don't have as big a setbacks as the faster racing classes. This allows Club 40 to be raced on smaller fields than can host a three-pole pylon racing. After my article in Model Aviation, Club 40 picked up in popularity dramatically. However, when the Thunder Tiger Pro 40 was discontinued, it caused a lot of issues, and there aren't many 40 engines left. Allowing the Evolution 46NX in Club 40 should help the class regain popularity. Club 40 was raced at the 2015 Nats and the 2016 Pylon Nats in Muncie, Indiana. It's going to be held again this year, 2017, and if you are an intermediate pilot, these are good second airplanes, and you should come to Muncie, Indiana, and enjoy some competition. You'll get to see the fast airplanes. The event's on July the 16th, Sunday, and there's practice on Saturday before, and we'll be setting up. I raced this airplane at the 2016 Nats in the gold class. It has an OS-46AX2 engine. It's a very nice engine, and if you're interested in Club 40, you can get the LA Racers and the Sky Raiders from Airborne Models, or from StigallHobbies.com, or a number of other vendors. You can also get the SIG 4-Star 54 from Tower Hobbies, and you can get the OS-46AX. And literally, you can order on a Friday and get your airplane kit on Monday or Tuesday and race the following weekend. That makes entry into the racing class very easy. But you still have to make sure your airplane's maintained properly, or else you won't finish the races and you won't win. The people who put the effort into racing are the people who win. You can try to level the playing field and make the classes so that it's purely a pilot skill event. But when you prepare your own airplanes, just like in NASCAR and other racing classes, reliability and driver skill and everything is what adds up to a winning combination. In Club 40, just like in Q40, you have to be able to take off, fly the course, not cut the pylons, you have to be able to land, and you have to be able to get ready for your next heat race. It's an exciting thing seeing four of these airplanes, even though these are only 100 mile an hour airplanes, battling it out in a race. Just like the quadcopter guys have found out, flying a course is much more fun than just drilling holes in the sky. If you like warbirds, we have racing classes for warbirds. With warbird racing, there's been a wide range of rules throughout the years. There was an organization called the SWRA, the Scale Warbird Racing Association, and at least initially they used scale judging as part of the point system for winning races, and they also had a wing area to engine size chart. The racing uses breakout times to control the speed of the classes. In warbird racing, you typically have bronze, silver, and gold. On a particular size course, like the RC Pro Warbird Racing course, which is 700 feet long, the breakout times are 2.5 minutes for bronze, 2 minutes for silver, and 1.5 minutes for gold. If you go faster than the breakout time, you get no points for a heat. So this allows a wide variety of airplanes, and almost any warbird can compete in the warbird racing, depending on the local rules for the engine size and that kind of thing. RC Pro eliminated the wing area chart and the scale judging and favors just having the breakout times control the racing classes. If you have a 200 mile an hour airplane, you can break out of the gold class time of 1:30 if you fly a tight course. A 160 mile an hour airplane can win just as easily as a 200 mile an hour airplane when the pilot flies a good tight course, doesn't cut any pylons, doesn't mess up his landing gear on landing, and is consistent. Of course, a faster airplane means you can fly a bigger course and a sloppier course, but hopefully you strive to fly a good course. The World Models and Airborne Models have been good friends to the pylon racing community. They've come out with a number of airplanes that are popular in the warbird racing classes, in the NMPRA EF1 electric class, and they manufacture the LA Racer and the Sky Raider Mach 2 for Club 40. This is a relatively new airplane called the Strega 40 that has pre-installed electric retracts. It comes in four different color schemes. This is the scale color scheme. It also comes in yellow, red, and white. It has CA hinges, so you can easily add your own trim to it, or you can strip and recover the airplane. This airplane was developed in conjunction with Richard Verano, who's a world champion pylon racer, but it's still a good sport plane. It's built to handle the power of a YS-115WS Warbird Special Engine, or a 91, even though it's effectively a 40-size airplane. These airplanes can go over 160 miles an hour, and they're capable of winning races. The biggest thing is, it's built to be strong, and it's built to handle the power of the bigger engines. And there are many other Warbirds that could be used in the Warbird racing class. As I said, almost any Warbird can race in the Warbird racing. Warbird racing was added to the 2016 Pylon Nats in Muncie, and it does use a wing area chart. On this particular airplane, it has 550 plus square inches of wing area, and the engine can be up to a 1.29 four-stroke or a 0.95 two-stroke engine. So you have options with the Warbird racing. In RC Pro Warbird racing, we even allow electrics because there is no wing area chart. Both forms of racing are popular. The NATS rules are more popular in Northern California, and the RC Pro rules are used throughout the southwest of the U.S. Hopefully, people around the country will get interested in Warbird racing and they'll move to other areas. A lot of pilots who race in the advanced classes raced in the Warbird race at the 2016 NATS. The World Models also has a Spitfire 40, which is also beefed up for racing. So you have a lot of options with Warbird racing. I created a Facebook page called RC Warbird Racing, and that Facebook page has over 1,000 likes. So there's a pretty big audience for Warbird racing. If you aren't racing Warbirds at your local club, get some guys together and start practicing. You don't have to set up pylons, but it's a good idea to set up pylons. Speaking of which, in 2001, after a friend told me about the need for a well-designed pylon, I created a pylon called the Portable Pylon, and I published the plans for it. And then I went to the 2002 NATS in Muncie, Indiana, and I built them for the AMA. They're still using those pylons. And I created a smaller version called the Ultra Portable Pylon. You don't have to use those pylons. You can just simply set a piece of 20-foot PVC in the ground and use that as a pylon. Or you can build a structure out of wood, but you need something to fly around. And the biggest thing is, with pylon racing, until you start flying on the course, you're just boring holes in the sky. So a lot of the content on this channel will be about flying around either a two-pole or a three-pole course. We may actually get into some quadcopters or use quadcopters to show demonstrations of the course, but our main focus is going to be on model airplanes. Everything I've shown so far has been glow-powered, other than the RC Pro Warbirds, which could be electric powered. But for you guys who are into electrics, there are a lot of options as well. This is an NMPRA EF1 legal airplane. It has the minimum square inches required, And in NMPR EF1, there are specific motors that are allowed, and they have a weight limit on the batteries, and the batteries have to be 4-cell lithium polymer batteries. But one of the goals for EF1 was for the ARF makers to be able to build planes so that there would be plenty of variety and a good supply of airplanes for EF1. EF1 does not allow fiberglass fuselages or composite wings or composite tails. It does allow for molded or fiberglass cowlings and hatches and wheel pants. Now, I don't have wheel pants on this one because I'm working on molds to make new wheel pants with a different mounting system. And also on my field and my house, wheel pants don't work too well because the field's not super smooth. You can fly an EF1 at almost any club that has a reasonable runway. Of course, they work great on pavement, but even if you have a grass field, as long as the grass is reasonably short, you can fly an EF1 off of your field. These airplanes reach 110 to 120 miles an hour. This is using an APC 8x8 prop, and the smaller course was defined for EF1 racing that's similar to the course used by the bigger classes, in that the pylons number 2 and number 3 are 100 feet apart, but the distance from number 3 to number 1 is 300 feet, and the distance from number 1 to number 2 is also 300 feet. And what this does is quickens the pace of the races. You can actually race these airplanes on the AMA short course, which is used by Sport Quickie, that's 475 feet long, but the batteries don't last very well when you run on the longer course and you may start to run out of power. With electrics and the motors being specified and the ESCs are limited to a particular dollar limit, the cost is contained to a degree. And because the airplanes aren't molded composites, they can be built from balsa and foam or just balsa and plywood. Approval of designs is required for EF1, and there's an approval board that approves designs for EF1, and once a design is approved, it's grandfathered in unless there are rules changes that make it illegal. This was one of the early airplanes that Dan Kane and Jerry Small designed, but it's still a very good airplane. This is the Outrageous, as manufactured by the World Models. They also have a similar airplane that uses basically the same fuselage, wing, and stabilizer, and it has a different fin and rudder and a different hatch, and it's called the Scarlet Screamer. There are many other airplanes like the Proud Bird by Great Plains that are EF1 legal and are available as ARFs. And Hobby King has an airplane, and a number of other manufacturers have airplanes. A lot of the longtime pylon guys like to build their own. I'm actually bringing out a new kit of the Miss Cosmic Wind, and it'll be available soon as a laser cut kit. And there are many laser cut kits that have been or will be available for EF1. So if you like electrics and you like speed, these are good flying airplanes and they're club friendly. You have to be careful on takeoff because the engines have so much power that they will pull hard to the left, and you have to get somebody to launch your airplane. You can theoretically start from a standstill, but it's better to have a helper when you're flying pylon planes for a lot of reasons. Unless you're a good pilot, you need somebody to help you trim the airplane, and you also need somebody to help you with traffic because the airplanes are going through the air at a pretty high rate. And because they're low drag, you typically have to have an extended landing approach. You can do a curved approach, and you have, but you have to be careful about stalls. You can fly EF1s on most any club field that can handle glow planes or gasoline planes. And you can peacefully coexist with the sport electric flyers as well. This is a little P-51 that I got from the World Models back in 2005, and it's been flying ever since. It originally had a gearbox and a Speed 400 motor in it, and it wasn't all that fast. And I've made a number of modifications to the airplane over the years. The World Models came out with an airplane called the Voodoo EP, and I got a canopy from a Voodoo EP that's the Reno-style canopy, and painted it to match my airplane, and I switched it out. I changed out the gearbox to a direct drive motor and redid the motor mount. They had made similar changes to the Voodoo and to later versions of this airplane. And this airplane's a fun little airplane. It has a 39-inch wingspan. RC Pro has a racing class called Mini Warbird Racing. The World Models has quite a few airplanes that fit into this specification, and there are a lot of foamies that also fit into the specification. And basically, we allow a 3-cell lithium polymer battery of a specific weight, and it has a minimum wingspan and a minimum weight. In racing, you almost always have a minimum weight because heavier airplanes don't turn as fast as lighter airplanes, and pilots have to have boundaries or they will push them. The Voodoo EP version of this airplane actually has retractable landing gear. I like this one because it's got the fixed gear and I have slightly bigger wheels because my field is not as smooth as some fields. I'm going to have racing in 2017 for the Mini Warbird class at my field from August through October. And one of the things that I've done with this airplane is added a battery hatch, like the battery hatch that's on the Voodoo EP. Originally, it didn't have a battery hatch, and I just had a balancing lead hanging out the side, and I balanced the batteries that way. That was after lithium polymer batteries became popular. Before then, I was putting nickel metal hydrides in it. So this airplane has been through the ringer. As a matter of fact, I've got to replace the stabilizer on it because I broke the joiner and didn't get it glued back properly. And you can probably see the gap between the spinner and the cowl. I need to put some spacers in and move the motor back a little bit. So I'm going to be making some modifications to this airplane. I'm actually going to try a stabilization receiver, even though it's a pretty stable airplane. When you get smaller airplanes like this in the wind, they can get bounced around pretty good. So stabilization, artificial stabilization may make it even more fun to fly. These airplanes, with the current Mini Warbird spec, can reach 80 to 90 miles an hour. And the course that's used is actually a shortened version of the half-A AMA course, with the pylon 60 feet apart and 234 feet from the number 3 pylon to number 1 and number 1 to number 2, which makes 10 laps exactly 1 mile. So it's very easy to compute the speed of the airplane. This is not the only electric option that you have besides EF1 in this. A lot of foamies have come out and people have done their own racing classes based on particular airframes. As a matter of fact, I'm doing one myself, and I'll show you that airplane now. This doesn't look like a pylon racer, does it? Well, it's not. It's really an aerobatic airplane designed for air-to-air combat with the motors in the wing and no propeller up front. And it's made out of EPO foam, And the intended purpose is to try to knock each other out of the air with your airplane. These airplanes can basically almost fly standing still. And on this one, we've even gone a step further and used differential thrust on the propellers. It has a rudder for directional control, and of course it's got full ailerons. It's got all the control surfaces. It doesn't use differential thrust for its directional control, but you can add it as an option so if you can do some really wild stuff with it. But if you take this airplane and tone it down, it makes a very nice flying airplane on that little course that we're using for mini warbird racing. So I'm going to have racing for the Handyman Twins by the Wings Maker, which is also distributed by Airborne Models, on my field from August through October. This airplane comes in two different versions. It comes in a pre-assembled version that already has the motors installed, and has the servos installed, and all you have to do is glue in the stabilizer and glue on the rudder post. You can see a little line right here, and put in two push rods, install the electronic speed control and your receiver, and you're ready to fly. The cool thing about this airplane is it can bounce off the ground and still be able to fly. That's very convenient for people who are starting in pylon racing. And like I said, even though it doesn't look like a pylon racer, with these twin motors, especially with 8x4 props spinning up, it sounds like it's going fast as it can be. We do allow props up to 8x6, and you get a little bit more speed, but you lose speed in the turns when you go to the higher pitch props. So another fun class of racing under development, and at least I'll be running some races with it on my field. This is another little electric airplane. It's a Hobby King Fun Fighter AT6. They have a P-51, they have a Spitfire, they have several other planes. One of the cool things about these airplanes is they're extremely simple. They only have ailerons, and they have a separate servo for each aileron, and elevator control. There is no rudder. If you're used to using rudder, it can feel a little awkward not being able to do corrections, especially if you're banked up and you need to slot out a little bit. With these airplanes, you can't do that. But they come receiver ready. The motor's already in them. And all you need is a approximately 850 milliamp battery. You can fly them on 3 cells or 4 cells. With a 4 cell, they go about 90 miles an hour, and they're quick. With a 3 cell, they're in the 60 to 70 mile an hour range. One of the cool things about these airplanes is that they can be landed on grass fields easily. Hand launch, land on the grass field, and they only cost in the $100 to $125 range for the plane, not counting the battery and the receiver. Many different classes of pylon racing exist. Many groups create their own classes that meet their needs. On rcpylon.tv, I'll be showing a lot more videos of specific details about the airplanes. I also intend to interview pilots and talk about their racing careers, talk about their RC pylon careers, and find out what they like to do besides pylon racing, because pylon racing is simply one aspect of RC modeling. Some people are purely focused on RC pylon racing, but by staying focused on all different kinds of pylon racing. I've been able to enjoy a lot of different activities, and I'm going to be trying to inspire people to try pylon racing and to try new techniques and the things that they already do with pylon racing. And I do a lot of videos on running engines. I've already got about 150 videos on YouTube. I plan to try to have a new video for rcpylon.tv at least once a week. I may not be able to meet that schedule, but more than likely, I can find something to make a video about, because while I'm working, I can just videotape my work and show what I do. My purpose is not to show off what I can do. It's simply to try to inspire other people to do things and to try things. One of my videos on cheating quickie wings has been viewed over 20,000 times. Now, that's not flight test numbers. And another video I did on cutting foam cores has been viewed about 100,000 times. So please subscribe to the channel, share it with your friends, and write to me about what you want to see on RC Pylon TV. As I said, I'm going to do interviews with pilots. I'm going to show techniques. There will be just a whole wide range of topics, but everything's going to be pylon related. I do have another YouTube channel called rcfieldbox.com that I'm starting, and it'll be about sport planes and anything RC related, but it won't be focused on pylon racing. So I hope you'll subscribe to RC Pylon TV, provide feedback, share it with your friends, and we'll see you at the races.